That's good. I'm turning 24 again. This time just with added tax. But yeah, thank you so much for just your love. And believe me, we do receive it. We love each and every one of you also. And yeah, I don't want to take the focus away this morning. I want to focus on the Word of God and what God has really been speaking to me and preparing for me. And I say for me first because I always share this and I always say this to our staff, to our pastors, that the Word of God, that even when we prepare, has to first speak to us before we can speak it to the rest of the congregation. And so God, as Roxanne was sharing earlier on, God has really been speaking to me about this series, about where we're going as a church. And I pray that you will also, you know, see where God is taking us, the journey God is taking us, and the season God is taking us. Because as believers, we know that even as human beings, there's different seasons. You know, like we now still in winter, you know, then we're going to see spring, and then it's going to go to that, you know, awesome summer where it's just humidity galore. But we're in all seasons, but even there's spiritual seasons. And so God is just, you know, directing us and working through different seasons and stages. And you might be aware, as you know, as Elder Gavin was sharing, you know, I'm unpredictable in many ways, and sometimes our staff cringe when they hear when I want to meet up with them about something new that I want to start, because they're like, sure, have we not have enough new things happening? But I'm also, I just don't like, I have this methodology, if I can start there. I don't like stagnant water. I don't like stagnant water, because can I tell you something? Maybe it started off fresh, but if you leave stagnant water where it is, eventually it's going to smell. And eventually it's going to become unhealthy. Because they always say, survivalists always say, don't drink from water that is standing still. Drink from water that is moving. And even scripture says that we are living water. You know, that means that we cannot be drinking from places that is just standing still. So I'm encouraging you that as we embrace new things, embrace it also with me. Don't be stagnant. Don't be saying that, yeah, but, you know, we just want to stay in this water. You can stay there, but I promise you one thing, and I say this, don't take offense. Eventually, you're going to smell. Because if you stay in that stagnant water, people will be able to identify you by what water you are staying in. That's not even the message, but I just feel God is saying, don't stay in water that is standing still, because people will be able to identify where you are in your water journey. But this morning, we are starting a new sermon series. So good morning to each and every one of you, for especially our visitors this morning that are here for the first time. I didn't see your hands that you are visiting here, but if you are here with your families, just welcome to you especially. Pray that God will just richly bless you as you are journeying here as a visitor, first and foremost. But as always, we say you might be visiting, but we pray that you get planted in the house as well. And especially for those who are watching online, maybe you in your jammies with a cup of coffee, but that's all good. We pray that you don't miss out too much about what's happening in-house, because there's a difference between being in-house, a different atmosphere. But we love you, and we appreciate you, and we have technology to able to get to people that might not even be close to church or might be unable to come to church. But this, like I said, this morning we're starting a brand new series. Did anybody get the memo, the competition about, you know, trying to figure out what the new series? They made me do funny things. It's like they made me, like, you know, squash wine gums, and then I had to throw a grape in the air. Even AZ there was laughing at me the whole time. You didn't hear him in the background, but he was making it very hard for me because I had to try and keep a straight face. And then it made me drink, you know, it wasn't wine, it was just grape juice. So they made me drink grape juice. It was just weird. I think they tried to make it as difficult as possible to try to identify what the new series is. But did everybody try to figure out what the new series is? So what is the new series name? Organized Church, no. Okay. I'm not going to give it away yet, the series title. You just have to hold on to that for now. But let's pray as we prepare for God's word this morning. Heavenly Father, Almighty God and King, we come before you. We thank you, Lord, for just allowing us, Lord God, to be able to be here this morning first and foremost, Lord. And I pray, God, for each and every person, whether online or here in person, Lord God, that you would just continue to reveal more and more of yourself. I pray, Holy Spirit, will you just continue to fill this auditorium, Lord God. I pray, Lord, that your presence will be so tangible that we would just hear your voice. There will be no distractions, Lord God. There will be no hindrances, Lord God. But, Lord, that you would just continue to speak to us, cut through the marrow and the bone. And I pray, Lord God, as always, that your servant will decrease and you will increase. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. If you have your Bibles with you, and I always encourage you to bring them to church, doesn't matter what translation you are reading from, you might be the New King James Version or the King James Version, the ESV, the NIV, whatever, you know, translation you have, just bring it to church. And so you can turn with me to the book of Luke, or some might know it as the Gospel of Luke, to chapter 5, and we'll be reading from verse 37. If you have your Bibles and you are there, you can just say amen. The scripture should also be on the screen. And so let's go for it. And no one pours new wine into old wineskins. Otherwise, the new wine will burst the skins. The wine will run out and the wineskins will be ruined. No, new wine must be poured into new wineskins. And no one after drinking old wine wants the new, for they say the old is better. So, the series that we are now going into for the month of August is new wine. Yeah. And I'll explain just now the reason why I believe, because God's really been speaking to me about this particular series, about where we're going and what He wants to really impact and start stirring in our hearts. But let me just unpack this in our introductory for this. I never cared for, believe it or not, you can call me a liar, but you can phone my mom and you can ask her. Believe it or not, I never actually cared for pizza. No, true story. As a child, I never liked pizza because I never really identified with regards to eating cheese on pizza. I didn't enjoy pizza and I didn't enjoy cheese on pizza. So I really, when we went out to go for takeaways and they went to the pizza place, I was like, nope, I don't want pizza. Like, all I wanted and all I lived on was hamburgers and potatoes with Worcestershire sauce. No joke. That's all I lived for. If you give me a hamburger with potatoes and put some Worcestershire sauce on it, I loved it. You are my best friend. I could not see myself eating pizza with cheese on it. It was a big no thank you. But then it happened. Somewhere along the way, someone encouraged me to try a slice. I don't know why I took the risk. I'll be honest, I don't know why I decided to actually just take the risk and eat the slice. But I tried it, and guess what? I liked it. After all these years, I was like, what? I missed out on my whole childhood on eating pizza. Now I can eat pizza, and you can see I can eat pizza almost every day. Then there was a time and a period I didn't eat calamari. I just didn't like calamari. It's like, who eats calamari? What's wrong with them? And then it happened. Somebody encouraged me and says, just try it. Just take a bite. And I took my first bite of calamari. And I'm like, whoa. Now I like it grilled, fried, however you want to do it. I just love it. And I can eat it any time of the day. Breakfast, lunch, supper, midnight snack. I love calamari. And then I asked myself, why did I miss out on all this? I have avoided calamari for so long. I've avoided pizza for so long, but now I love it. I couldn't believe that I was missing out on all these years of eating this because I thought in all my time as a child, I thought that the real food was just hamburgers and potatoes with Worcestershire sauce. But I missed out on all the goodness that there was of all this nice food. I can't believe that I missed out because I was such a creature of habit. You know that slogan? That term that they use? A creature of habit. Now, let me just say, we'll put it on the screen. What does it mean? What is defined to be a creature of habit? What is the definition of a creature of habit? Let's go for it. A person who follows an unwavering routine, someone who always wants to do things in the same way. That means, in the simplest term, I just don't want to change. I'm set in my ways, and it is my way or no way. You know that song? I did it my way. Yeah, next, I'll start an album. But here's the thing. And please don't put your hands up. This is not a moment to put your hands up. But sometimes, and I say sometimes, we are all creatures of habit, even in church. We sit on our old ways. We refuse to alter to different new ways. And even if it means something new, exciting for us, something different and great, we refuse to change because we think hamburgers and potatoes are the real food. And here's the thing that I want to share with you that I believe God was speaking to me and He was sharing with me about this as I was preparing for this. God was just saying that things are not continuing as they were. And the reason we know this is because God has given us a discernment of times and seasons in which we are living in right now in the present. I'm not going to be speaking on giving credit to all this nonsense that's happening in the world right now. Many of you are on social media. Many of you got TVs. Many of you got radios. Many of you are on Facebook. So believe me, I know and I see the comments and the disagreements and all the things that you not attest to. But we know about the Olympics. Okay, so we're not going to spend too much time on that. But we know about all these things that's happening. But even take Olympics away. Myself, for example, we were just discussing the other day. We tried to look for a movie. Okay? Yes, your pastors watch movies. And we tried to look for a movie. But did you know, there's almost no movie. Go try. No movie where they do not actually, use the Lord's name in vain. Like, it's actually not normal. Like, and Roxanne was actually making a statement, why do they have to do that? And we literally spent more time looking for a movie than trying to just, actually watching a movie. I think we eventually just switched the TV off and went to bed. Because we're like, it's taking too long to just look for a movie that's actually just decent. Because half the time, either that they use the Lord's name in vain, or, okay, so it's some children here, so please close the ears right now. Or it just literally opens, the first scene is a naked scene. And you're like, why? And then we even go further. And I would, for those, show of hands, who's parents here? A lot. Okay. I would encourage you, just hear me right now. I would encourage you to watch some of the things that they classify as children's programs. You'll be shocked. You'll be shocked. And the reason I don't want to spend too much time, but that is indications of where the world is going. And the Bible even speaks about there's going to come a time where they're going to be using the Lord's name in vain, where they're going to be doing all these evil things. And those are going to be signs of where the world is going, as signs of when the second coming is preparing. And so this, as Christians, it shouldn't be a shock. Yes, it is not always easy. It's frustrating, but it shouldn't come as a shock. But I believe that God is preparing us, and that's why I believe this series is so important, because it speaks about new wine. A new wine prophetically, and hear me now, you can write it down, prophetically, the theme for new wine is actually speaking of the Holy Spirit presence. And I believe that there's going to be a season, and we're in it now, where we need to just receive the Holy Spirit, the presence of God, to filter in and overflow in every area of our life. But we need to be ready. New wine, as I said, is a prophetic theme of the Holy Spirit. And I believe as I was praying about this series that we are drawing into this new era where God needs to just show up more powerfully with more glory. And this is a season of new wine where we are about to encounter God like we have never, ever before. Our walk with God should never be as business as usual. We have a God who never changes, yet is constantly doing something new and exciting in our lives. His will is eternal, but His ways are always evolving. In ancient times, coming back to our opening scripture, introductory scripture about new wineskins, people made wine through fermentation or the process of aging wine. New unused wineskins, usually made from the skin of goat or lamb, were the primary vessels for holding or the aging process of this wine. The new wineskins were filled with unfermented juice, okay? You need to get this. It doesn't start off putting wine into wineskins. It's unfermented juice. It means it hasn't gone through the process yet of being classified as wine. It is still unfermented juice. It is put into the new wineskin and left there to age for a period of time. New wine speaks of new life, freshness, a greater outpouring upon our lives. That's why even before, believe me, I believe this is the vision for the church this year. Remember what was the vision for the church? Greater. And so I believe there's going to be a greater outpouring of His power, of His Spirit. And that's why I believe this series speaks about new wine. Because there's going to be a process, an aging process of changing things around. That the old ways are no longer going to be suffice. We cannot do things as it was before. Things have to change. New wine has to come forth. Second Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, and I'm reading from the Amplified Version, says that is crafted in, joined to Him by faith in Him as Savior. He is a new creature, reborn and renewed by the Holy Spirit. The old things, somebody turn to your neighbor and say, old things. Don't say that old person. I'm watching you and I'm listening. You know, some of the husbands were like very hesitant to turn to their wives. All things, old things, the previous moral and spiritual condition have passed away. Behold, new things have come, because spiritual awakening brings a new life. You see, when new wine comes forth, there has to be a spiritual awakening. You cannot say that you have new wine, but there's no spiritual awakening around you. New wine only can fermentate in a place where there's a spiritual awakening that is about to burst forth in new things, new ways. And I believe as a church, as Sweetwaters, this is the season that we are going to be going into. And so we need to be ready. Only our new nature can contain the new growth. Good fruit, character, healing, maturity, Our dad has this for each and every one of us, his sons and daughters. He loves us where we are, but continually takes us to where we need to be. Always bringing forth spiritual awakening fruit and new wine in our lives. Now, let me just break this down because I feel as I'm unpacking the series, I needed to start off from a firm foundation of explaining old versus new. And when I say old and new, I'm not speaking about a younger generation versus an older generation. I'm just speaking about old ways of thinking versus new ways of thinking. Old systems versus new systems. New nature versus an old nature. So why do we want to put the new into the old? Because that's exactly what Jesus was referencing in the scripture about. You cannot put new into the old. But yet people still will try to put new in the old. And let me explain why I believe that this is the reason why some people, not here at Sweetwaters, but some people, want to put old into, or the new into the old. Because of our fallen, broken nature, we seek out more without making sacrifices. We desire the new, but we don't want to let go of the old. Craving change, yet allowing things to stagnate. Desiring the presence of God, but not willing to make room for God. You see, new means that it's going to be a time of stretching. Because new wineskins are new for a reason, because it's allowing room for stretching. So we don't want to sacrifice. Why? Because we love the comfort zone. Don't tell me to serve. Don't tell me to volunteer. Don't try to tell me that we want to change things in the church, because I love the way things are. I know where my parking spot is. I know where my seat is. Don't ask me to change. How dare you ask me to serve in a different section? Why? Because we don't want to sacrifice. We don't want to be stretched. We don't want to have the spiritual maturity, the capacity where God wants us to take us. Why? Because we don't want to sacrifice. I'm happy where I am. Yet, when things go bad, how quickly we say, Lord, where are you? Lord, I need you. And God is saying, but I need new wine in you. You need to release the old ways. The old thinking, I need new wineskins. The old is not going to work anymore. Your old way of thinking, to think that you can do things in your own strength, your own ability, that it's all about you, is not going to work anymore. If you need a breakthrough, if you need a miracle in your life, guess what? It takes sacrifice. You cannot say, Lord, I need you with one hand, but you're still holding on your old ways with the other hand. Sacrifice means lifting both hands to surrender to God. One hand worship is no longer going to suffice. Now say this here. You have to lift both hands because it almost indignifies the fact that you're holding on to something yet you're still holding on in the old ways. Full surrender means lifting both hands. Let me just say, I don't care if you're like holding on like you're carrying a TV. We'll get you to change light bulbs eventually. But that's full surrender. You cannot say that I serve God and I want all of God, but you're still friends with the devil. Hard word, but a truthful word. Because old ways mean sometimes that there's some things and addictions that you're going to have to let go of. That you're going to be like, I want the presence of God. But let me just say, the presence of God means that the scripture even speaks about that he is light. And when light enters, darkness has to flee. You cannot remain in darkness but still want the presence of God in your life. You cannot say, God, I want to have you in my life, but I still want to dabble in this. I still want to dabble in that. I still want to do this. I still want to do that. When you know it's wrong, New wine means new wineskins. It means your vessel. You as a person have to be something different than the world. We cannot have it both ways. There is so much our Lord desires for us to be and have, but it cannot coexist with an old fallen nature. As sons and daughters, our Father gives us both the power and the authority to choose life and not death, and to have a new life. Now, let me just explain this also, because we speak about old versus new, or why they want to choose old when they need to have new. So old wine, okay, old wine. New tastes different than old wine, because even the scripture says about when they are continue drinking old, they don't want new, because they don't like the taste of new. New, let me just say, new will always taste differently, because we are so accustomed to the old ways, the old thinking, the old nature. Then when something new, something that means breakthrough, comes through, we actually miss it, because we're so accustomed to the old. The problem is that if you are so used to the old wine taste, then when something fresh and new comes your way, you have no desire for it. You have no desire for something new because you like the old. Let me explain this. I like illustrations. Have you ever seen, I'm not saying you, but have you ever seen a movie, you know, where they go to these posh, you know, restaurants? You know, where they get the waiter with the, you know, he's like got the cloth, and then like he's like, give me the most expensive bottle of wine on your menu. And then the waiter comes, and how they do it, those posh restaurants, they don't just pour it out and they're like, here you go. They open a bottle in front of the customer or the client, and then they give them a little, you know, taste. So then you get the guy, I don't have a wine glass here, but I'll illustrate. So then the guy goes, have you seen it? And I'm like, dude, what are you on about? But here's the thing. Then he's like, then he decides, at that moment, he decides if he wants to have the whole bottle or, you know. So then what sometimes he does, then he's like, give me the bottle. And he looks and he's like, 1994. It was a good year. The grapes taste fruity. The harvest was good. Or they look like, 1993. Nah, I can taste the bitterness in this year. And we laugh because sometimes we don't want a new wine, because we just like that. We got with new experiences. And when we look at, what do we look at? We look at our past. And if the past was a bad year, if we look at 2020, we're like, your COVID, was a bad year. I'm not going to serve in a church. I'm not going to sacrifice because it was a bad year. And so every time opportunity arises, we go back and look at the bottle. And we're like, nah, I don't know if it's a good year for me now. Maybe next year I will try. Maybe next year I will sacrifice, because this year wasn't so good. Can I tell you, we cannot do that. We cannot sip on the old wine. Those who like to drink the old wine will always say that the old is better, because the old wine means more alcohol. Because remember, the process takes longer. So the longer it sits in those wineskins, the stronger the wine gets. But here's the thing about old wine. It's a temporary good feeling. But Jesus would like to compare the physical old wine with the spiritual new wine, because new wine is eternal. New wine is eternal. Many in the world will care less about your new wine. And I just say this now for some of us that says that I'm embracing new wine. There's going to be people in this world that will not care about the new wine. They like the old wine. And old life just is how they like it. And let me just say, don't give up on those people. Many Pharisees and priests eventually got on with the new wine also in the Bible. But also, don't let the rejection discourage you. There are plenty out there who realize that the old wine isn't cutting it anymore. And they will completely reorder their lives at the chance they have when receiving new wine. But if you are going to help get people off the old, and I say this for those who have new wine in their lives, and you want to get other people to receive new wine, if you want to do this, if you want to get people off the old wine, you have to actually invite them into a life that is actually new. Everyone today is selling old wine marked with new wine labels. Let me just say that again. Everybody today is selling old wine marked with new wine labels. That means it looks nice on the outside because I have a label that I'm a Christian, that I come to church, that I read my Bible twice a day, but you're Monday to Saturday. You don't want to see me when I'm like, I want to clap that guy. If the traffic is just too much, I want to like just, you know. If I don't get my food by KFC, I want to Karen them. That's not new wine. The problem is we make the wineskins more important than the wine itself. See, it's never about us. It was never about us. God created us for worship, for companionship. So it was never about us. It was all about Him. So it's not about your wineskin. It is about the wine that you have in the wineskin that is most important. An old wineskin with new wine will eventually become empty. A Christian without the Holy Spirit will eventually become empty. Because you can only give from what you have. Out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. And so, believe me, when that new wine is not sufficing, if that is not coming up, all you'll be sitting with an overflow of your mouth, what you will speak is old wine methodology. Hatred. Striving. There are far too many fakes and frauds. We can't just invite them to buy the label. We'll have to show them how to put new wine into new wineskins. We need to invite them into a community of Christ followers who read their Bibles more than their phones and TVs, who love the truth, who worship God with all their hearts, who are selfish to materialistic things, who rejoice when they suffer, who share with the poor, who visit the hurting, who have one another in their homes to sit at a table and rejoice in God's blessings, and who have a real concrete hope that evident in even in the deepest pain and suffering in their life. That is what new wine looks like. What God has for us, and distinctly right now, is a particular anointing for this new era. A new wine from heaven. But we have to let go of the old wine and the old wineskins. Isaiah 43, verse 16 to 21 says the following, and I'm reading from a Message translation. Forget about what happened. Don't keep going over old history. Be alert. Be present. I'm about to do something brand new. It's bursting out. Don't you see it? There it is. I'm making a road through the desert. Rivers in the badlands. I provide water in the desert. Rivers through the sun-baked earth. Drinking water for the people I choose, the people I made especially for myself, a people custom made to praise me. Now let me break this down. Break it down. Now let me break this down for us in this passage. When it says there in the opening words, forget about what happened. It doesn't matter how your grandma did it, how your mommy or your daddy did it, your first church or your third pastor did it, you'll always get the same old results. Doing things the same old way, Forget about it. That was then. This is now. Then it carries on. Don't keep going over old history. Oh, we like to be historians, especially when we are dealing with couples. You know, when we're fighting with our spouse, we bring back the past. We bring back the history. It's irrelevant how your Sunday school was taught in 1960, or how your ushers marched in 1970, or how your outreach witnessed in 1980, or how the worship team sang in 1990, or how the anointing flowed in 2010. Can I even go further? It's irrelevant how many souls were added to the kingdom in January 2024. It is August 2024 now. There is bigger, better, and greater things waiting for us. As soon as we finally make the deliberate decision to leave the same old comfort zones and step into a new era, a new season of new wine. Maybe God is trying to do a new thing in your life, in your ministry. Could it be that you are unwilling to go with His flow? Not your flow, but with His flow. Maybe God is trying to do something new in your marriage, on your job, in your career, in your health, in your children, with your finances, in your family. But He can't, because you can't let go of what it was before. You are just like, but it was like this in 1960. Yes, God is the God of the past. He's the God of the future, but He's also the God of the present. And sometimes your hurt can be the blockage to your blessing. Because sometimes God is wanting to do something new in your life, but you're like, but God, can we change that? I'm just thinking about it now. Okay, go with me. Because oftentimes God wants to do a miracle and a breakthrough in your life, and He speaks to you about changing things in your life. Things that you know you need to change. Maybe that change is forgiving the person. The band can start coming on the stage. But it's about forgiving the person. And you're like, but God, you don't know how they hurt me. You don't know how they offended me. You don't know what they did. And God's like, but you have to change. You have to let go. I'm doing something new. Do you not perceive it? No, because, but God. Can I ask you this morning, if that's you, don't put a hand up, but if that's you, if you're struggling with this, and I'm not just talking about unforgiveness, but if you're struggling where God wants to pursue you, where God wants to do something in life, but you have so much hurt, so much pain of the past, and you're like, but God, you don't understand. Can we change that but God to say, I was there, but God took me through. I was in that low place, but God lifted me up. I was in a place of unforgiveness, but God gave me grace. Because can I tell you something? If we struggle to forgive other people, then we don't understand grace. Because the same God that could have not let His Son die on the cross, because of how you did things, could have said, I need to save you, but I'm struggling with unforgiveness, my child. So I'm not gonna sacrifice my son. Sometimes we're gonna have to get a bit of a fivefold ministry club to just wake us up to say, it's not about us. It's never been about us. It's about His new wine, but it's how we receive it. Do we have some old wine skins in the house this morning? Because can I tell you, If he's got old wineskin, it's time for you to change it. Because you will never be able to have new wine in that wineskins. Because the scripture even says, once the wine comes in there, the new wine comes in, you will never be able to contain it. And so what will happen, it will burst, and it will be wasted. Some translations actually say wasted. It means that you will waste what God is doing in your life. Because you're holding on to past, you're holding on to things that is hurting you, and you're saying, but I cannot move forward into new things. So what you do, you waste it. I think if we are to lead like Jesus and follow his example, we must constantly examine our wineskins. A new heart is our new wineskin. A renewed mind and a changed action are our new wine. And let me just say this. The best tasting wine. It will always be, the moment you give your life to Jesus, let me just say, it will always be a good year. It will be the best year. Because new wine will always be good. As a vessel for the Holy Spirit, we need to ask ourselves, is this wineskin helping to preserve and distribute the wine, or is it putting at risk of spilling it, letting fall on the ground to be wasted? You'll never taste God's gourmet meals if you keep limiting God to the same old potatoes and hamburgers all the time. It's time to just be adventurous. It's time to step out with boldness and with courage to say, maybe God is wanting to do something great in my life. But I need to make the choice. No more potatoes and hamburgers only. I want to taste some calamari and pizza. I want to have some new wine.